Hello, Kisha. Good to be here with you.
Hello, Marcia. It's very pleasant to be here. And I wish also to say hello to our fellow English-speaking people listening to us and everyone also attending here.
Very good. I'd like to take this moment to say good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. My name is Marcia Trajano in English, and I'm speaking from Nashville, Tennessee in the U.S. We, Richard and I, would like to thank you all of you who are here joining us in this live YouTube transmission of the Deuxième Congrès Spirit Mondial, or the 10th Spiritus Congress, which is, as I said before, broadcasted live this weekend. So we started yesterday, October 14th, and will continue till tomorrow, October 16th. Our first activity of what we call block three of this conference is an amazing, amazing roundtable, which is held in Portuguese, Inner Transformation of Youth and Children. And this activity will be followed by a program in English. And that program includes a presentation with Jussara Korngold, a musical presentation, ending the day with a roundtable in English. Richard, do you want to say something before we turn into Portuguese?
I'm very excited about what we're about to have today in this block. And this is so incredible to have all this audience as well. Thank you very much to everyone attending. It's a fantastic reward from all the effort that has been done by all the team. And really, thank you. Thank you so much. Stay tuned. I think that it's going to be really the best program ever.
I like that. Thank you. Thank you so much, Richard. In Portuguese now, bom dia, boa tarde, boa noite a todos que estão aqui conosco. Meu nome é Márcia Trajano. Eu estou falando de Nashville, Tennessee, nos Estados Unidos, e gostaria de convidar, na realidade, gostaria de dar um abraço carinhoso, virtual, e para todos que estão adentrando no bloco 3 do 10º Congresso Espírita Mundial. Esse congresso que está sendo realizado a cada 3 anos, desde o início do SEI, Conselho Espírita Internacional, o que significa que estamos, nesse momento, também celebrando o 30º aniversário dessa organização. Parabéns a todos. Nesse bloco teremos algo bem diversificado. Iniciaremos agora em português com a mesa redonda, a reforma íntima na educação dos jovens e das crianças. Após a mesa redonda, estaremos recebendo a nossa querida Jussara Korngold com a palestra maravilhosa e fora, depois dela, teremos um número musical e outra mesa redonda, essa agora em inglês. Mas vamos agora agradecer aos participantes da mesa redonda em português. Terá a participação da nossa querida Sandra Borba, da Lúcia Moisés, da Miriam Duzzi, da Manuela Vieira e a Eliana Daher. Elas conversam nessa mesa redonda sobre a reforma íntima na educação dos jovens e das crianças, todo esse trabalho dirigido pela Silvana Elia da Suíça, da organização UCESS. Vamos então iniciar nosso trabalho agora. Muito obrigada.
Olá a todos, sejam muito bem-vindos. Eu sou Silvana Elia, presidente da União Espírita Suíça. Nós estamos vivenciando o 10º Congresso Espírita Mundial, promovido pelo Conselho Espírita Internacional e realizado pela União Espírita Francesa e Francofônica. Num ano muito especial em que estamos comemorando os 30 anos do Conselho Espírita Internacional. Esta é a terceira mesa redonda desse 10º Congresso Espírita Mundial, e nessa mesa redonda dialogaremos sobre o tema A Reforma Íntima na Educação de Jovens e Crianças. E para trazerem contribuições sobre o tema ao longo de toda a nossa conversa, temos aqui conosco nossas queridas convidadas, Eliane Daire, da Suécia, Manuela Vieira, de Portugal, Sandra Borba, Lúcia Moisés e Miriam Dulce, do Brasil. Todas dedicadas trabalhadoras na divulgação do Espiritismo, em especial na área da infância e juventude. Queridas, sejam todas muito bem-vindas, com todo o nosso carinho e gratidão.
Nós agradecemos a toda a comissão organizadora do Congresso pelo gentil convite, e é uma honra e uma alegria muito grande estarmos juntos para conversarmos sobre essa temática tão relevante e que nos toca o coração de uma forma muito especial. Gratidão.
O microfone, Manuela.
Olá, é com muita gratidão que cumprimento a todos e dou as boas-vindas, porque é uma honra participar neste congresso. Espero estar à altura.
Olá a todos, é uma alegria grande participar desse momento tão significativo da história do Movimento Espírita Internacional. Vamos ter a oportunidade de conversar sobre a esperança do mundo, sobre o futuro da humanidade, o jovem e a criança. Agradecida e cumprimentando a todos que se encontram aqui na telinha.
Olá, queridos companheiros do Movimento Espírita Internacional. É uma alegria realmente muito grande estar com esse grupo de amigas aqui presente e com vocês, conversando sobre esse tema tão importante que é a educação moral da criança e do jovem, nesse século já tão desafiador. Estamos juntos.
Bem-vindos a todos, a todas, a esta mesa redonda. Sejam bem-vindos, que possamos ter momentos felizes e reflexões acerca do importante tema. Bem-vindo a todos.
Queridas, para iniciarmos a nossa conversa, eu gostaria de lembrar que As bases da reforma íntima foram lançadas pelos espíritos superiores lá no Livro dos Espíritos, né? Na questão 919, quando Kardec pergunta aos espíritos, né? Qual o meio prático mais eficaz para se melhorar nesta vida e resistir ao arrebatamento do mal? E a resposta muito simples dos espíritos, um sábio da antiguidade nos disse: conhece-te a ti mesmo. E é sobre isso que nós vamos conversar com vocês hoje aqui. E para começar o nosso diálogo, né, a nossa conversa, eu gostaria de pedir a vocês que nos falassem sobre a importância da reforma íntima para o espírito imortal. Sandra querida, nós podemos começar com você?
Podemos, é uma alegria. Evocamos também o Livro dos Espíritos, de modo especial, a questão 115, que nos vai apresentar a nossa condição humana. Criados simples e ignorantes, nós temos a destinação de alcançar a felicidade. Essa destinação, ela vai exigir de nós o esforço no sentido do progresso. Óbvio que há um grande caminho, uma grande jornada, espíritos imortais que somos, vivenciando os cenários dos renascimentos para atingir o progresso intelecto-moral. Então, estamos todos nessa destinação, e daí a grande importância e necessidade da educação ser mobilizada em todas as direções para que esse espírito encontre, nesse processo educativo, que é a própria experiência reencarnatória, os caminhos de superação, os caminhos de resgate, naturalmente, e principalmente a sua melhoria. Então, a educação é a grande proposta para que, de fato, nós consigamos atingir aquele objetivo que Jesus já havia dito para nós, conforme registro de Mateus, quando no Sermão do Monte ele nos dá a grande dimensão da existência humana, sede perfeitos. Então, é aí, estamos caminhando nessa busca.
E resgatando essa última fala da nossa Sandrinha, que nos leva até o Sermão do Monte, nas narrativas do nosso querido Humberto de Campos, em que vem nos falar sobre a beleza daquele momento, porque nós nos conectamos ao Sermão do Monte ao nos identificarmos nas fragilidades, nas dores, nos nossos processos de autoaprimoramento. E o grande convite do Cristo ao nos apresentar as bem-aventuranças foi exatamente o de que alcancemos essa perfeição. O ser de perfeitos, né, o convite do Cristo, nos lembra que nós temos todo esse potencial a ser desenvolvido no convite do brilho à vossa luz, né? E ao mesmo tempo nos remete a uma fala de Emmanuel, em que ao nos apresentar essas reflexões sobre o ser de perfeitos, nos lembra que nós, de fato, estamos ainda bem distantes da perfeição, mas ninguém está distante do aprimoramento constante. Então, esse aprimoramento constante, que é o do dia a dia, naqueles pequenos passos dados na direção do nosso processo educativo, de nos desvincularmos dos nossos atavismos, dos nossos vícios morais, para nos abrirmos ao homem novo, esse é um processo legítimo de reforma íntima, transformando os nossos paradigmas, as nossas histórias e edificando um caminho mais saudável, né?
É verdade, Miriam. E pensando bem, não é? A reforma íntima é um processo. E lembrando aquilo que encontramos na questão 685A, em que Kardec elucida-nos sobre a questão da educação, não aquela educação intelectual, mas aquela que forma caráteres, isto vai nos remeter para a atenção que nós devemos ter neste momento para o processo educativo das nossas crianças e jovens. Ou seja, nós temos que começar a ter um novo olhar para esse processo educativo, para que o processo educativo seja auxilie, de facto, aquela mudança das nossas disposições morais. Não é? Precisamos de ir adentro.
Exato. E realmente é muito importante a nossa atenção para essa educação das crianças e também dos jovens, porque através dela é que nós conseguimos também incentivar a reforma íntima também do nosso próximo. É muito importante estar atento para esse processo.
Exato. Eu queria lembrar também a questão da família, dos pais, né? Como é importante que eles estejam atentos até mesmo para fazer a própria reforma íntima, né? Começar por eles. Essa consciência de que depois que eu estou aqui constituindo uma família que tem esses espíritos que Deus enviou para mim, para que eu ajude no aprimoramento moral deles, eu também preciso estar mais consciente do que eu sou, de quem eu sou, de onde eu posso melhorar, quais são os meus potenciais. Enfim, esse é um tema que a gente ainda vai continuar, não é, Silvana? Temos muito ainda para conversar sobre isso.
Estamos só começando e vocês já trouxeram aqui tanta coisa que a gente já está querendo mais. Vamos continuar, porque tem muita coisa para vocês ainda trazerem para nós. Vocês tocaram em temas tão importantes. E um que eu gostaria de destacar agora é sobre a reencarnação, né? O processo reencarnatório, né? Quão importante é esse processo para que a gente tenha a oportunidade de exercer a reforma íntima, não é? Então, fale um pouco para nós sobre a importância, né? Também a importância, vamos da importância da... Saímos da importância da reforma íntima para o espírito imortal e agora a importância da reencarnação para o espírito imortal.
Olha, eu gostaria de lembrar... Gostaria de lembrar que a nossa Joana de Ângeles, ela usa uma expressão muito significativa relativamente à reencarnação, colocando a reencarnação como um processo educativo, e eu diria, data vênia, a benfeitora, né? É o projeto divino em relação a cada um de nós. E costumo usar pessoalmente a expressão cenários de aprendizagens, né? A reencarnação, ela é um cenário de aprendizagens. Então, nós estamos, criados simples e ignorantes, destinados à perfeição para alcançar a felicidade, vivenciando as chamadas experiências. A nossa Manuela lembrou muito bem os comentários de Kardec na 685A, né, de O Livro dos Espíritos. Então, nós estamos nesse processo, e nesse processo ela usou uma expressão que é fundamental e a gente deve falar nessa expressão ainda nessa mesa redonda: as disposições morais. Porque vivenciando a experiência dos cenários, nós estamos dentro de situações onde, de repente, os vícios, as imperfeições, as limitações, as profundas dificuldades que carregamos, fruto principalmente da nossa ignorância, tudo isso vai reclamar de nós esforço de todos os agentes vinculados ao processo educativo, não
é? Sandra, daí podemos pensar na reencarnação como uma ferramenta terapêutica.
Opa! Exatamente.
Sem dúvida, não é?
Sem dúvida.
E daí a necessidade de nós percebermos a criança que temos. Há bocado a Lúcia falou que os pais têm que estar também vigilantes consigo mesmo. De facto, aquilo que Jesus nos ensinou, vigiai e orai, significa estar presente. Estar presente no momento e atento a tudo, não é? Sejam os pais, sejam os educadores, para que essa terapia aconteça. Seja o processo educativo, não é? Então, o processo reencarnatório é uma chance, é uma oportunidade, é a misericórdia de Deus. E nós não podemos desperdiçar de maneira alguma, porque de facto nós nascemos para o nosso processo educativo. Não é? Seja com expiação, seja com reparação, seja com aquilo que for, mas é para crescermos. E isso Deus conta com os pais, no fundo são os pais que têm que dar uma resposta, não é? Diz-nos o Evangelho que a cada pai será perguntado o que fizeste, não é, da alma que te foi entregue.
Grande responsabilidade, não é?
Sem dúvida, sem dúvida.
E essa relação, né, olha que interessante, trazendo o olhar de um processo que é terapêutico, no sentido da transformação do ser. Enquanto um cenário de aprendizagem, a nossa Joana de Ângeles utiliza a metáfora da metodologia. Ela vai dizer que a reencarnação é um método educativo da providência divina, para que nós possamos nos aprimorar, para que nós possamos encontrar caminhos de vivência das nossas experiências para podermos ressignificar os nossos caminhos, plenificando-os de um real sentido de felicidade que nos imprima um senso de desenvolvimento. E isso faz muito sentido quando percebemos essa oportunidade da reencarnação. E numa leitura também, trazendo em perfeita consonância com as falas da nossa querida Sandrinha, da nossa Manuela, que a reencarnação é um processo de confiança. A reencarnação é uma confiança da providência divina no potencial transformador do ser. E por isso, todo esse processo reencarnatório é organizado de forma tão cuidadosa por benfeitores espirituais para que todo um processo, toda uma jornada reencarnatória seja vivenciada com segurança para que o espírito reencarnante alcance os seus objetivos e finalize a reencarnação melhor do que quando chegou. E para isso, esses processos educativos são fundamentais. E a nossa amada Mei Mei, me recordei agora, sempre nos lembra que os espíritos, as crianças, elas reencarnam confiantes. Ela utiliza esse termo, é uma relação de confiança. Os espíritos reencarnam confiantes de que serão educados no tempo certo, da maneira certa, para poderem se desenvolver de forma segura, não mais se apegando aos atavismos e vícios do passado. Então, é uma relação realmente de confiança, para que sejam apresentados outros parâmetros mais saudáveis, mais felizes, para que gravitemos para a unidade divina, como nos diz Paulo na questão 1009, também de O Livro dos Espíritos.
Olha a responsabilidade do educador, muito grande, não é? Porque esta confiança pressupõe que cada ser é único, e nós não podemos cuidar de todos como tudo igual, certo? Daí a postura do educador, a presença do educador, a firmeza, o saber observar, o saber sentir, é importantíssimo para que esse processo que a Miriam acabou de falar aconteça. Não é? Isso é, o que é que vocês acham? Para mim é fundamental perceber que não é um rebanho tudo igual. Cada ser tem a sua história, não é? A reencarnação mostra-nos isso. Temos cada um com a sua bagagem, as suas tendências. E se não houver esse olhar especial para cada um, o processo fica aquém dessa confiança.
É muito, muito bem lembrado. Muito bem lembrado.
Gosto muito de usar uma expressão ao evangelizador chamada a expressão evangelizador artesão. Uhum. Né? Então, em vez da linha de produção tão conhecida pela Revolução Industrial, então nós vamos pensar, eu acredito nisso, artesanalmente. O que é isso? Cada um é um. Eu sou filha de uma família de 6 filhos, né? E minha mãe dizia assim, eduquei tudo igual. Eu costumava brincar com ela e dizia, deve ter acertado com 1 e errado com 5. Porque cada um, né, tem uma maneira de ser. É um olhar, é uma maneira, um jeito, um medo, né? É um impulso, é uma criatividade. Então, essa colocação é fundamental. É preciso ter um olhar sensível, né, para podermos dar conta daquela perguntinha que a Manuela lembrou, que está lá no Evangelho, capítulo 14, que Deus perguntará a cada um, o que fizeste do filho que eu vos confiei? Tremo, toda a vida que eu leio essa pergunta.
A gente tem que lembrar também que exatamente porque são espíritos em processo de evolução, eles também esperam da gente, né, esperam dos educadores, dos pais, que desenvolvam, que estejam atentos aos potenciais, porque eles têm potenciais. E é uma pena quando a gente ouve histórias, nós que trabalhamos na educação ouvimos tantas e tantas, de espíritos ainda juvenis, ou mesmo infantis, que retornaram e depois, através da psicografia, vem cobrar da família. Mãe, você fazia evangelho no lar e não deixava a gente participar. Mãe, você nunca me levou para a casa espírita, para evangelização. Por que isso? Eu poderia ter evoluído muito mais, eu poderia ter me adiantado muito mais. Ou até mesmo, né, no sentido de deixou para lá, não cuidou tanto, poderia ter cuidado mais. Então, trabalhar potenciais, observar, por isso Santo Agostinho, né? Observe, faça como um bom jardineiro, veja lá o que tem de coisa que está saindo fora do lugar para ir podando, observe as tendências. Muitas vezes, muito orgulho, aquelas coisas que nós sabemos, muito egoísmo. Então, é importante, sim, esse olhar, como a Sandra fala, né? Sensível, como nós falamos, de modo geral. Uma expressão que nós gostamos muito, a escuta sensível, o olhar sensível, saber perceber até naquilo que não fala, até aquilo que não é dito. Quem é esse espírito que Deus colocou nos meus braços? O que é que ele precisa? E o que é que eu posso fazer para entregá-lo melhor ao final da sua, dessa presente encarnação? Não é isso?
Aliás, Allan Kardec diz-nos que educar é a arte de formar caracteres. Ora, a arte de modelar, aquela arte de ajudar a crescer, aquela arte do toque, de saber, de olhar, de sentir, para poder abrir caminhos a este novo ser. E isto nós temos que levar em conta, não só os pais nos seus lares, como nós, educadores, também nas casas espíritas, precisamos de entender que arte é essa? Né? Como é que nós vamos auxiliar as crianças e os jovens que vêm ter connosco nessa formação desse caráter? Né? E, sobretudo, auxiliar os pais a perceberem que a formação desse caráter está muito mais nas mãos deles do que nas nossas. Porque eles estão com os filhos 24 horas. Eles têm que sentir o que é que sai dos filhos e o que é que pode entrar. Não é para poder extrair e limar. Portanto, os artistas terão que ser eles. E nós, os auxiliares dos artistas. E isso é fundamental neste novo olhar que dissemos há bocado sobre a educação espírita.
Com certeza. Muito bem lembrado. A importância de percebermos que somos as crianças e os jovens são indivíduos. Observar cada um nas suas tendências, nas suas potencialidades, mas tentando lembrar também que, como espíritos, eles têm a sua bagagem, daí a sua individualidade, daí a importância dos educadores e dos pais, dessa tarefa da educação.
Lembramos que o Santo Agostinho, na mesma mensagem, que é a gratidão dos filhos e os laços de família, ele chama a atenção para uma condição essencial da educação. É observar desde cedo as inclinações, os instintos. Né? Porque eu sou brasileira, sou nordestina, e aqui a gente usa uma expressão, abestalhamento. Essa expressão aqui, num congresso mundial, deve ter gente horrorizada, mas significa que a gente fica assim meio bobão, né? A criança nasce, é o netinho, é o sobrinho, aí a gente fica tudo, né? E aí Santo Agostinho dá uma prensa em nós, dá uma forçada, dizendo, observe, porque nenhum processo educativo ele prescinde dessa observação, que é o que Kardec coloca. Observação, tato. Ele usa essas duas expressões que são extremamente ricas. Então, tem muita gente que acha bonitinha a criança mal educada, né? A criança desbocada, a criança agressiva. E aí o Santo Agostinho vai nos dizer exatamente isso. É preciso observar, porque está lá também na codificação. O homem precisa ser cultivado, o espírito precisa ser cultivado com um campo. Então, é preciso identificar essas necessidades profundas, essas inclinações. A Miriam colocou na fala dela, logo no início, e todo esse processo que a gente chama de reforma íntima, educação moral, aprimoramento, enfim, né? Isso requer principalmente o quê? Novos valores, novas experiências, né? Às vezes uma palavra, alguma coisa, um exemplo, uma oportunidade que a criança recebe, que o jovem recebe desde cedo, isso vai ser fundamental em seu processo de transformação, né? Para que a gente possa seguir adiante cultivando este campo fértil que é exatamente a criança e o jovem.
Então, já que você trouxe, né, a imagem da criança e do jovem como esse campo fértil, né, e por isso nós, educadores, né, evangelizadores, somos os semeadores, não é? Porque o campo, existe esse campo, né, tão grande para semear. Como vocês acham que pais podem estimular, né, os jovens no processo de reforma íntima, de autoconhecimento que leva à reforma íntima?
Eu gostaria de colocar o seguinte, a importância do exemplo dos pais. Tem um ditado que diz que a criança não faz o que digo, que faz o que eu faço. Né? Então, a importância do exemplo que os pais podem dar, né, na formação da criança e do jovem. Também a importância dos pais também fazer esse trabalho de autoconhecimento, da busca interior. E o outro ponto que eu também acho importante, que também é importante, é se tiver oportunidade, levar também à casa espírita.
Esses são pontos importantes que a Eliane traz, e especialmente quando a gente fala de juventude, e mais especialmente ainda nesse cenário que nós estamos vivendo, ainda em pandemia, em que muito se tem estudado, se tem dialogado sobre o desenvolvimento socioemocional das nossas crianças e dos nossos jovens, que passaram ali 2 anos com uma privação social, e o impacto disso também na construção das relações, esse momento tem potencializado reflexões em especial referentes a sentido de vida, a busca de propósitos existenciais, e tem promovido espaços de uma reconexão com um certo alinhamento reencarnatório. Para que eu reencarnei? O que eu estou fazendo aqui? Qual é o meu propósito? E principalmente quando a gente fala de juventude, em que ocorrem muitos movimentos de massificação, que são movimentos em que nos padroniza em estereótipos sociais, em curtidas, em grupos e modalidades de comunicação, numa tentativa de identificação, né, de identificação de grupo, é muito importante haver esses espaços de autoconhecimento, resgatando lá a primeira pergunta que foi colocada na abordagem da nossa Silvana, na introdução, para que nós possamos favorecer espaços de fortalecimento de um senso identitário. Quem eu sou? Para que eu reencarnei? Quais são os meus propósitos de vida? Quais são os meus valores, os meus princípios? O que me diferencia do outro? E esse é um processo belíssimo de desenvolvimento, porque nós saímos de um elemento de massificação, de eu me igualar aos outros, para eu me diferenciar. O que me diferencia? Que é o que a nossa Joana de Ângeles fala do processo de individuação, de me conscientizar do meu processo de indivíduo, que é diferente do individualismo no sentido do egoísmo, né, da egoico, mas numa construção de um processo de fortalecimento de um autoconhecimento que vai me favorecer um autoconceito mais sólido, uma autoimagem mais sólida, que, por sua vez, vai desencadear no fortalecimento de uma autoestima, do autoamor, e isso é fundamental para vivermos até em consonância com a lei máxima do nosso Cristo, amar a Deus sobre todas as coisas e ao próximo como a si mesmo. E essa autoestima, por sua vez, vai desencadear num autocuidado, numa autogestão, na forma como eu vou investir o meu tempo, as minhas energias naquilo que nos nutre, que nos promove saúde e que vai promover a autonomia. Então, é um processo, é uma linha, né? Parece um encadeamento, mas é muito fluido, que nos favorece a compreensão, muito especialmente quando falamos de juventude, para poder promover caminhos de autoconhecimento, para promover caminhos de libertação a partir de uma plena consciência do ser. E isso, naturalmente, está muito relacionado à perspectiva das potências da alma. Né? Não tem como falarmos em reforma íntima sem nos lembrarmos do nosso querido Leon Denis, e muito especialmente quando ele vem falar desse processo de investir nas potências da alma, no poder do pensamento, da vontade, da consciência, do livre-arbítrio, do amor, da dor, né? Compreendendo, para que a gente possa ressignificar o nosso ser e investir na nossa reencarnação.
Ô, Miriam, tudo isso que você está falando, eu concordo, acho importantíssimo, só tem o seguinte, nós temos que lembrar, sobretudo quando nós estamos falando em reforma íntima, que você se refere, né, à questão do jovem, da juventude. Kardec mesmo, quando ele fala a questão 385, ele vai abordar isso. Aquela criança que durante 15 ou 20 anos ficou ali sob cuidados dos pais, agora vai mostrar a sua verdadeira identidade. E aí nós temos que nos lembrar disso, que se numa situação ideal nós poderíamos ter tudo isso, né? Mas como o nosso papel aqui também é de trazer respostas para os grandes desafios que o educador, que a família tem, talvez fosse interessante que a gente se lembrasse disso, que muitas vezes aquele espírito, quando vai assumindo a sua verdadeira identidade, ele traz uma bagagem que pode não ser tão positiva e que entra em choque com a família. Além disso, nós sabemos que, do ponto de vista psicológico, na juventude é aquele momento de afirmação de identidade. Então, um dia é comum até isso, meninos que são levados pelos colegas chegarem na evangelização, querem conhecer, querem ver, mas já disseram muitas vezes, ah, já passei ali pela igreja evangélica, eu já estive em outro lugar, pretendo ir para o outro, porque eles estão em busca de autoconhecimento mesmo. E a gente tem que ter essa paciência e compreensão de entender que reforma íntima é o tema do nosso congresso. Eu imagino, nós estamos na terceira mesa, isso já deve estar sendo falado, já deve ter sido falado aí em outras oportunidades. É um processo que exige autoconhecimento e uma consciência forte de si mesmo. Saber quem eu sou, o que é que eu tenho feito, o que é que eu preciso me aprimorar. E nosso papel de adulto que está do lado é ser espelho, ajudar, porque nem sempre ele vai conseguir. Pelo contrário, a gente aprende também nas neurociências que essa área aqui, que seria a que vai favorecer a esse entendimento de quem eu sou, de quem eu atuo, essa área se desenvolve até os 20 anos. Então, eu estou dizendo que nós estamos trazendo isso para mostrar o quanto é importante, sim, essa identidade, essa formação com o grupo, esse sentimento de pertencimento, essa descoberta de quem eu sou, o que, que eu vim fazer, mas nós, adultos, temos um papel importantíssimo para ajudar. Porque nós, adultos, temos dificuldade na reforma íntima, porque a nossa tendência é nos vermos, ah, mas isso comigo não, isso é com o outro, o problema é do outro. E até assumir, não, eu mesma que tenho, eu tenho esse problema, eu tenho que melhorar nessas e nessas situações, ou nesses e nesses traços. Então, o meu alerta é isso. Temos hoje uma juventude que tem muita opinião, uma juventude que tem muito acesso a Nídia. Eu não diria conhecimento, eu diria conhecimento entre aspas, porque a gente sabe que é muito raso, né? Muito extenso, mas é muito raso. Sabe muita coisa, mas nada muito aprofundado. Então, para a gente ser esse ajudante, eu diria assim, ser o espelho, olha, você viu isso, viu aquilo? Como é que foi? Como é que está? Ajudar nesse processo, não sei o que vocês acham.
Processos de comunicação, né, Lúcia, que você traz, e de diálogo. O ser espelho é exatamente promover esse diálogo de autoconsciência a partir da fala. Muito oportuna a sua colocação, e a gente, de fato, identifica caminhos para que eles possam se identificar nas relações, a partir dos diálogos que são ali construídos, e realmente fortalecendo uma consciência que dê recursos pessoais para que eles possam utilizar o livre-arbítrio da forma mais segura, a partir de uma boa fundamentação. É como se fosse uma nutrição da alma, né? Às vezes, enquanto pais, a gente se preocupa com a nutrição do corpo, com o conhecimento a partir das escolas, daquilo que pode ser rico em termos de informações do mundo, mas nós estamos falando de uma nutrição da alma, que é exatamente essa consciência moral, né? Que até a Manu havia trazido mais cedo, do conhecimento intelectual, mas da formação moral, que caminha junto para dar sentido, inclusive, aos conhecimentos, né? Muito, muito bom. Gratidão.
Miriam, e há uma coisa que me preocupa. Às vezes nós perdemos o sentido essencial da educação, porque para se chegar a jovem, antes foi criança. E agora, aqui na Europa, pelo menos, a criança aos 4, 5 meses já vai para a creche. Passa mais horas do que um trabalhador no serviço. Portanto, o tempo que está com os pais é um bocadinho à noite e ao fim de semana. Como é que isso acontece? Quando nós queremos criar vínculos para tal autoestima mais tarde se fazer forte, quando nós queremos que a criança cresça autónoma, responsável, mas não com aquele sentimento de abandono. Portanto, há uma série de situações que é tomado por normal na nossa sociedade, onde se acredita que a criança é educada na escola, na creche, no sítio onde vai, onde passa a maior parte do tempo, e depois culpabilizamos os outros, não é? Quando vemos que a nossa criança afinal não está tão bem quanto gostaríamos que tivesse, e inclusive separa-se muitas vezes a educação espírita, que é uma educação de 24 horas, que é uma educação de presença, não é? Para o momento que vai à evangelização, e os pais estão convencidos porque foi à evangelização, a minha criança está a crescer espiriticamente muito bem. Quando, se calhar, o centro auxiliou em determinado aspecto, mas a consolidação das coisas tem que ser feita no lar. Portanto, quando o jovem chega, a jovem, e se teve uma vida neste sentido, não é? Mais solitário, mais desapegado à família, e quando chega naquela fase da adolescência, uma fase onde há uma maior, alguma perturbação ou altos e baixos próprios da idade, não é mal nenhum nisto, e quando nós queremos que essa criança comece a ter consciência do ser que é amado e por aí fora, muitas vezes os pais sentem que perderam o fio à meada e já não sabem como falar com os filhos, porque está naquela fase que ele amua, que vai para o quarto, que fecha não sei o quê, e os pais perdem-se completamente, muitas vezes dizendo, ah, se calhar o meu filho está obsidiado. Não é, o pai e a mãe faltaram durante muito tempo, não é? E isso é preciso, eu acho que o Centro Espírita tem muito aqui que auxiliar os pais, não é? A fazer entender as várias fases do desenvolvimento infantil, desenvolvimento juvenil, o que é que a criança precisa mais que aspectos precisa mais, para além daquilo que a Eliane falou logo no início, que é o exemplo, o bom exemplo. Não é? Porque muitas vezes nós esquecemos as palavras ou esquecemos certas coisas que vimos, mas aquilo que aquelas coisas nos fizeram sentir, nós não esquecemos. E então a criança cresce com aquela sensação, aquilo que fez sentir, determinada atitude, que já nem se lembra muito bem que palavras é que o pai ou a mãe usaram, mas a forma como sentiram, aquilo que mexeu, e isso vai fazer moça mais tarde. Então, eu sinto que a nossa obrigação, dentro de tudo aquilo que nós temos estado a estudar, a nossa obrigação é, de facto, de auxiliar os pais a refletirem neste processo. E quando temos os jovens nas nossas mãos, nós não temos que dar respostas aos jovens, nós temos que dar questões, como Kardec nos deu no Livro dos Espíritos, muitas questões para nós pensarmos com a nossa cabeça e para eles refletirem. E quando o jovem reflete, ele pensa, não é? Ele pensa na sua situação e ele quer respostas, porque ninguém quer viver na dor, certo? Então, a nossa tarefa é ajudar, de facto, os miúdos a pensarem, porque a escola, durante muito tempo, pecou nesse aspecto. Dá conteúdos e não ensina a pensar. E quando chega um momento que temos que pensar, ninguém sabe pensar. Ninguém sabe ter uma ideia. Não é? Então, a nossa tarefa é mesmo refletir. O autoconhecimento, a pergunta é, o que é que eu fiz? O que é que não fiz? O que é que eu fiz? O que é que me fez fazer? Ou o que é que me fez não fazer? Não é? São questões que até são interessantes, porque o jovem gosta de desafios, o jovem não gosta de tudo assim de bandeja, ele gosta de sentir-se desafiado, não é? E portanto nós temos que aproveitar isto e ao mesmo tempo auxiliar os pais, porque eu acredito que os pais, se não fazem bem é porque também não é o desleixo completo, há de facto quem se desleixa. Mas, no fundo, às vezes não sabem porque não fazem para eles mesmos. Porque nós, toda a sociedade, ensinou de alguma forma a viver um pouco com as máscaras, não é? Com a manipulação. Então, é isto. A família muitas vezes vai manipulando uns aos outros e tal. E os miúdos aprendem porque são esponjas.
Manuela, eu gostaria, na sua fala muito enriquecedora, de lembrar... Primeiramente, você tem completa razão. É uma sociedade em que nós, muitas vezes, abrimos mão dos nossos papéis. Né? Já há algum tempo, estudiosos afirmam que os pais têm tido uma atitude estranha de não se tornarem, de fato, os educadores, terceirizando, vamos dizer assim, né, os processos educativos. E quando você fala, a casa espírita recebe a criança.
Lúcia, você está sem som, querida. Acho que travou aqui a nossa vida.
Eu diria, sim, que a casa espírita recebe a criança achando que a família está fazendo o seu papel, quando, na verdade, nem sempre isso ocorre. E uma das situações boas, a Sandra pode continuar...
Não, tô lembrando o seguinte, que hoje a nossa própria concepção de evangelização abrange os diversos espaços, que não apenas aquele espaço do chamado momento pedagógico do encontro na casa espírita. Né? Então, hoje nós procuramos essa inserção, não apenas do jovem, da criança, no movimento. Né? Uma das coisas que mais me encantou foi o encontro de infância em Portugal, viu? Eu tenho essas lembranças aí que a dona Isabel me proporcionou quando estive aí em Portugal. Então, muitos espaços, a questão da família que você coloca, por isso a área da família hoje, tão necessária e importante, para que seja um trabalho de parceria, de comunhão, né? Porque chorar depois que tudo já está, vamos dizer assim, sacramentado, fica difícil. Né? Então, é importante lembrar isso que você colocou muito bem. É preciso dar ao jovem questões, perguntas, desafios. Né? Porque se a gente não faz isso, a gente não faz educação moral. William Damon, um dos grandes autores na área da educação moral, disse que nós temos que ter três atitudes fundamentais no processo educativo das novas gerações. Ele fala da disciplina, do limite e do desafio, para que nós não tenhamos que chorar, né, sobre gerações que, de repente, estão abandonando os valores e estão se situando apenas no egocentrismo, no egoísmo e na satisfação. Então, é preciso ampliar, de fato, essa percepção e perceber que os espaços educativos são muito além daquilo que a gente está, vamos dizer assim, condicionado a entender que realmente teria algum efeito positivo.
É isso mesmo. Lembrando que a reforma íntima, ele é um processo contínuo, né? Constante. Não é só na casa espírita, não é só no lar, não é só na escola. Estamos constantemente nesse processo de autoconhecimento e de reforma íntima. Queridas, nós estamos quase no final da nossa mesa redonda. Então, para finalizar, eu gostaria de convidar todas vocês a dedicarem uma palavra aos educadores, aos evangelizadores e aos familiares, para estimulá-los a prosseguirem nessa sublime tarefa da educação moral das crianças e dos jovens. E, junto com essa palavra de estímulo, as considerações finais de vocês. Por favor, Sandra, querida, por você nós começamos.
A infância é uma lei da natureza, é uma lei divina. E todos nós que temos a oportunidade de colaborar com os espíritos em processo de evolução, lutando nesses cenários de aprendizagens, é para todos nós não apenas uma honra, é uma oportunidade também de crescimento pessoal. Nós entendemos que ninguém educa ninguém, todos nos educamos. O processo é coletivo, ser pai, ser mãe, está muito longe dos arquétipos que aí a história do pensamento humano nos tem apresentado. Somos seres que temos muitas dificuldades, todos nós, mas que temos também todas as possibilidades de nos educarmos, de, em processos de autoeducação, nós colaborarmos com aqueles que Deus nos entregou para caminharmos juntos nessa jornada. Agradecer esse momento muito significativo, pedir desculpas por alguns regionalismos, mas dizer que foi uma alegria muito grande ver a nossa Eliana, a nossa Manuela, a nossa Lúcia, a nossa Miriam, Silvana, um abraço a todos, parabéns ao SEI, vamos lá, 10º congresso, parabéns, nós estamos de pé, isso é que importa.
Miriam.
Queridos amigos, reiterando esse momento, a relevância desse momento para os nossos corações, quando a nossa Silvana nos pede, né, deixar uma palavra de incentivo, a bem da verdade, nos vem duas. Prossigam e confiem. Semear é confiar na colheita. E existe uma colheita farta, sem dúvida, nos aguardando a partir das semeaduras que são feitas hoje, a partir dessa semente que é lançada no coração das crianças e dos jovens e que, de fato, oportunizam reflexões importantes que vão culminar nessa tão almejada reforma íntima, que é processual. E, muito especialmente, essa reforma íntima nos conecta com a vida, com a valorização da vida, com a valorização da reencarnação, com a valorização das relações que construímos, dos nossos afetos, a valorização do nosso tempo. Então, quando falamos de reforma íntima, nós estamos falando de valorização da vida e que possamos, de fato, colocar cada vez mais tempo na nossa vida, mas, muito especialmente, mais vida no nosso tempo. Que o nosso tempo seja investido de vida, de sentido, de plenitude, de amor. E finalizamos lembrando de Jesus ao nos apresentar esse grande convite, vim para que tenham vida e vida em abundância, que todos nós sejamos plenificados de vida, a cada uma das minhas irmãs que estão aqui conosco, a cada um dos que nos ouvem nesse momento, a toda a comissão organizadora do Congresso, muita vida, muito amor, muita plenitude. Gratidão.
a comissão organizadora está me dizendo que temos 2 minutos. Então, Manuela, a sua palavra de estímulo.
A minha palavra de estímulo vai lembrar que não há nem pais nem filhos perfeitos, mas nós temos que nos aproximar cada vez mais uns dos outros e, em vez de procurarmos ter uma imagem ideal, percebermos a origem do nosso mal para podermos amar mais, porque a educação moral pressupõe tato, observação, presença, e isso faz com que o amor aconteça. E nós, educadores dos centros espíritas, podemos colaborar. E mais uma vez, parabéns a toda a organização por mais este congresso e por falarmos de educação espírita, que é tão, tão importante.
Obrigada. Eliane?
Quero dizer, gostaria de dizer aos educadores, que a tarefa não é em vão. Eu quero dizer também que coloquem o amor onde vocês estiverem. Se você é educador, se você é pai, se chega uma criança próxima a você, ame. Porque fazendo isso, nós estamos dando exemplo daquilo que Jesus nos ensinou. Parabéns ao SEI pela realização do 10º Congresso Mundial.
Obrigada. Lúcia, querida. 1 minuto, Lúcia. Para finalizar.
Vale a pena educar, porque uma vez semeado, como disse a Elvira, que nós conhecemos a passagem, vai ser para a eternidade. O Espírito vai levar para a eternidade. E agradecer o convite, agradecer e parabenizar a todos nesse 10º Congresso.
Nós aqui agradecemos a vocês. Nós chegamos ao final dessa conversa, dessa mesa redonda, desse momento tão especial, certamente ficará guardado em nossos corações como uma mensagem de amor e de fortalecimento para que prossigamos com a nossa reforma íntima, que é o convite à nossa transformação moral. Nós agradecemos a todos, agradecemos ao SEI, à União Espírita Francesa e Francofônica que está organizando esse evento e daqui deixamos o nosso abraço carinhoso a todos. E continuem com o 10º Congresso Espírita Mundial.
Profundo agradecimento a Silvana, Elia, Manuela Vieira, Miriam Dulce, a Lúcia Moisés, Sandra Borba e todo esse painel maravilhoso sobre o papel do educador, da criança e do jovem. E estaremos fazendo uma pequena pausa de alguns minutos, voltaremos às 19 horas, horário da França. Richard, I'm sorry. Do you want to say something to everyone?
Just welcome and stay tuned for the continuing block and so many nice things to come. Thank you very much for attending again.
Thank you. We'll see you in a few minutes. Olá, queridos amigos, é com muita alegria que nós estamos aqui para convidá-los a participarem do 16º Simpósio Espírita organizado pela United States Spiritist Federation. Neste ano, é o nosso 16º, nós vamos estar celebrando presencialmente esse tempo de renovação. Nosso simpósio se realizará na cidade de Houston, no Texas, e também será muito especial porque a Federação Espírita dos Estados Unidos celebra, completa 25 anos de existência, um grande marco para todos nós espíritas. Contamos com a participação de vocês,
todo o simpósio será transmitido pelo nosso canal do YouTube no dia 5 de novembro de 2022. Até lá!
Hi, I'm Tanya Schwartz from the United States Spiritist Federation. I'd like to invite all of you for the celebration of the 25th anniversary of the U.S. Spiritist Federation that will happen in our annual symposium on November 5th, 2022, in person this time in Houston, Texas. The symposium will bring together several Spiritist speakers from all over the U.S. It is an event for the whole family. There'll be activities all day for kids and youth, besides talks and roundtables focusing on the theme, time for renewal. Yes, it is time for healing and regrowth. Register now at the spiritistsymposium.org website and join us in these festivities of 25 years of spreading Spiritism in the U.S. soil. For more information on Spiritism, events, centers close to you, visit the spiritist.us website. Hope to see you then. Take care.
Well, we have been very quickly pushed back into the stage because it is true that we are slightly late. So we will have to shorten the pause that was expected 10 minutes. And we're very sorry about that. So, Marcia.
All right, Richard. So we're back. And very quickly, it will be a very short introduction. We are now starting in the block three of our conference, our Congress today, with a lecture by Jussara Korngold. Jussara will be speaking about inner transformation in the Sermon of the Mount. And without much to speak here, Jussara, thank you so much for being here with us today.
Thank you, Marcia. Thank you, Richard. I've been enjoying so much the Congress. It's been a blessing. I think that in a way, if we miss not being together, not being able to embrace each other, physically speaking, without a doubt, we can feel all the energy and we have been able to be in so many different places, in so many homes and so many nationalities. So it's a great thing that we are having the opportunity of spreading this message virtually in this 10th World Spiritist Congress. And also one thing that I was thinking while listening to all the other talks and this beautiful roundtable that we had about the child, the education for children and youth, and obviously a very well, a very good comment that we had in terms of paying attention on how our us parents are educating our children, and so we need to educate ourselves as well. It goes completely in tune with what we are proposing here today in our reflections for today, like, you know, finding a pathway to inner transformation. Our intention, of course, is not to provide here a shortcut. There are no shortcuts in life. So we really have to do the thing that we have to do. We are here to grow. Is in the Spirit's book, for instance, in question 132, when Kardec asks why we are incarnated on Earth, why spirits are here, the answer that we receive from the spirits is exactly that we are here
to march towards our betterment, towards perfection. But I would like to propose our start reflecting upon the words of Jesus that was mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter 8, verse 32, when Jesus says, "You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." We understand that the words of Jesus are immortal, that there are many angles that we have to analyze each and every of the teachings that he has given us. So when we talk about knowing the truth and truth setting us free, we may think about many different areas in our lives. Knowing the truth about a certain situation, about other people, about our position in our job. But here, when we are talking about this, when in the angle that we wanted to lead you to reflect upon, is exactly about knowing the truth about ourselves. To start this process of self-awareness, because we cannot go in a process of inner transformation as we are proposing here. This is the main theme of our Congress, and actually a providential one, because I think that considering everything that the world has faced in the past 2.5 years, many people are now more mature, ready to take the next step, to meditate about their lives, about their values. So it is exactly the time that we have to think about ourselves, to think about the reality of our existence. Oftentimes, when we face the prospect of self-awareness and inner transformation, we may ask ourselves, why should we do it? Why do I need to change? I'm used to be the way I am. We know that no one is perfect, and I don't need to be perfect as well. So every time we think about it, when we try to continue and stagnate in this process of bettering ourselves, of self-enlightenment, we are going to delay our journey in achieving what we need most and what we are actually looking for, which is, to have peace, to feel happiness. So the focus here should be more about exactly that. What are my goals? If I go through this journey and I think about, understanding me, knowing my truth, going to a process of self-awareness, what is the goal that I need, that I want to achieve? What is the position that I am now? So the goal for most of us, at least, when you look around, when you talk to people, everyone will say the same. They want to be, to live with a peace of mind, having, inner peace, happiness, and good health. And another question that we have to ask ourselves in all this process of analyzing ourselves is, do I feel happy, really, truly happy the way I am? So we will face our current behaviors and see if they really are bringing peace and happiness into us. So in a way, in our current stage of evolution, it is not unusual for us to seek for happiness in material satisfaction. So we go after amassing fortune, fame, power, all related to the idea of achieving happiness through things and positions. However, it's quite evident that material things cannot fill up the void of the soul. It is inevitable. We cannot stop the growth of the soul in the same way that we cannot stop the soul, the growth of a child. And likewise, you know, the interests will change. We will no longer require toys to distract us, but rather wisdom to fulfill the thirst for knowledge of oneself and the mysteries of the universe. And when we think about childhood, and I mean, what are the things that will make a child happy? We will think exactly about that, about, you know, being well taken care of, you know, having toys to play with. But in the same way that today they really want this kind of toy, and next day they want a different one, and then they go through this process of being pleased with a very, very little, but only what attracts their attention. In our process of evolvement, going from, you know, and growing as well from this position of spiritual childhood to become adults, to going through these different stages, it is the same happens to us. So before, everything that was related to matter was what was attracting us. But now we continue trying to find the same satisfaction, but we have changed it. We are changing. The world is changing. People are changing. And of course, this brings a certain uneasiness, but this uneasiness is good because it leads us not to accommodate. So we come to a point where we will question, okay, I understand that this is the process, that I'm here to evolve. I'm feeling myself that the things that use it to make to bring me satisfaction is no longer filling this void that I have inside of me. But then the question is, how can I achieve this? How can I move forward? How can I remove the unnecessary layers? Because as useful as they were in the past for us, now they represent more like a hindrance to our progress. So this is when the first step comes with the realization that we need to grow. So there are many ways, of course, for us to reach this goal. We are not trying to propose here that the Spiritism has the only way, that is the only truth that will lead us to this self-improvement, self-enlightenment. But regardless of which one we choose, it will require our commitment. Everything that we want to do, that we want to improve, requires our commitment. We will need a new paradigm to change our way of behaving. We have to find a compass that will lead us to the north of our fulfillment. So, in our opinion, considering ourselves as Spiritists, as Christians, there is no better compass than the teachings of Jesus. And for this purpose, in a very simple way, yet so profound, Jesus proposed the Sermon of the Mount, the Beatitudes. His words were so extraordinary that scholars and religious figures from all times immersed themselves in analyzing all the angles of the teachings contained in the Sermon on the Mount. Mahatma Gandhi said that if all religious spiritual teachings were lost and only the Sermon on the Mount of the Mountain were left, remained, humanity wouldn't need anything else to live an ethical, moral life. And making a parallel with the teachings or the 13 virtues of Benjamin Franklin, which is very well known in the United States because of what he represents to the history of this nation. When he was very young, he certainly inspired by the Sermon on the Mountain, he decided to make a list of virtues that he needed to exercise to become a good person. And upon analyzing this list that, like I said, is totally inspired by the Sermon on the Mount, we can see the parallel in the way, the ability that he had to summarize all of the teachings in only one word. He wanted to achieve moral perfection. So he wanted to inspire people, or better yet, he wanted to inspire himself and to have a checklist if he was doing good, because he did that to himself. He was not making this list for others. So it goes along what we were saying before in terms of know the truth, know your truth, and then you will be set free. Because we cannot start making changes in ourselves that we have not yet seen the need to do it. So when we talk about the Sermon on the Mount, when Jesus says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven," Benjamin Franklin comes with humility. Then, "Blessed are those who mourn, tranquility. Blessed are the meek, silence, sincerity." "Blessed are those who hunger, temperance, frugality. Blessed are the pure in heart, cleanliness, chastity. Blessed are the peacemakers, resolution, order. Blessed are those that are persecuted because of righteousness, justice. Blessed are those who, when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me." It's industry. It's continuing going, persevering. But of course, in our presentation today, we are not going to go through all that. And actually, this parallel, you know, studying the Sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes, and the 13 virtues of Benjamin Franklin inspired me to write a book about it. This is already published in Portuguese, Transformação Interior. And then we will have next year in English and French as well. So we are going to focus more on the one that Jesus says about, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are those who mourn, who are afflicted, and blessed are the meek," with the correlation with Benjamin Franklin's teachings. So, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Humility. And then interesting, because when Benjamin Franklin was proposing this 13 virtues, he actually only listed 12. And on a certain occasion, he showed this list to a friend, and his friend's saying that he liked it very much. But there was one virtue that, in his opinion, was missing. And Benjamin Franklin asked it, "Which one?" And he said, "Humility." And Benjamin Franklin was so humble that he added humility after this comment from his friend. And to remind him what was the goal of achieving humility, he wrote, "Imitate Jesus and Socrates." Well, we know, we all know, why should we imitate Jesus? Jesus is the model, is the guide, as we have in the Spirit's book. Jesus is the path to truth and life. And like we said at the beginning, all of his teachings have several different layers that we have to penetrate it. And we will, upon constant study, upon constant dedication on our part. But when he said Socrates, why he referred to Socrates? Because we know that Socrates was one that was always emphasizing the need to get to know oneself. He was considered to be the wisest man of all his times. And also in question 919 of the Spirit's book, when Kardec asks about the most effective way of improving ourselves in this life and resisting the draw of evil, the answer of the spirits were very simple. A sage of antiquity has told you, know thyself. So in this form, you know, knowing thyself means we have to be humble enough to realize that there are certain aspects in our personality traits that need improvement, that we need to rid of, and that we have to do this work. So without humility, without, you know, being humble, if we think that, oh no, I'm wonderful, there is nothing wrong with me, because we always take this defensive position, we will not be able to start the hard work of looking at ourselves. And the question 919, I believe one of the questions in the Spirit's book that we are most commented in different occasions, in different talks and conferences and congresses, is then Kardec will say, okay, but I want to know how to do it, which is our point here. How can we do that? And then it's when St. Augustine comes and tells what he was doing, what was his formula to do that, which was, you know, to analyze himself, to analyze his actions, to see if he did the good that he could have done, if he has not committed anything wrong, any kind of wrongdoings. And what else could he learn from the day he had? But I really like in this question the comment from Kardec. Because Kardec was very pragmatic, and is in when we read those comments by Kardec that we realize the way of thinking of this spirit, this grandiose spirit at the time, you know, incarnate among us, but grandiose spirits, when he says, following the answers from the spirits, the reflection that St. Augustine gave to us, he says, when we are doing this kind of analysis, you know, this self-reflection, thinking about what we did, about our actions during that day, when we interrogate ourselves, did I do good today? The answers requires a categorical form. They can only be yes or no, leaving no room for any personal assertions that we may try to include. Because most of the time when we think about, we ask this question, my way of reacting to the comment of that person, let's say this, was it good? Yes or no? That's what Kardec is asking us. If we say, well, I would say so, but then we are already giving excuses, and we know deep inside that although it may not be that harmful what we did, we could have done better. So when Jesus says about blessed are those that mourn and are afflicted, Benjamin Franklin comes with the word tranquility. And when Jesus says blessed are the meek, Benjamin Franklin comes with the word silence and sincerity. So in this whole process of getting to know ourselves, first of all, we have to understand that we will have to leave our comfort zone. That's why it is so hard, because even when we are suffering, we stay there, we stay put. You know, sometimes we have to be dragged from situations that are being very damaging to us, but not knowing, not having the energy to move on, we just remain there until it becomes impossible. So we have to keep ourselves calm, in a state of tranquility, when we see that we are facing adversities. We should offer the other face when we are suffering aggressions, to remain silent. And above all, when analyzing ourselves, not only being humble, but being sincere, it will be essential for us to reach our goal. So we cannot be condescending with our mistakes, because in this process, we require a true knowledge of what we are. I understand that when we talk about, you know thyself, it's in theory, it may be very easy. Everyone that has tried that or are trying this know how difficult it is for us to see ourselves objectively, sincerely. We have built-in biases. We have our defenses that will hinder us to make accurate self-evaluations. We have blind spots. One thing that can help, it would be analyzing ourselves through the eyes of other people. So let's imagine that now I'm going to be analyzing what I'm doing from a different perspective. If I saw someone doing the same thing that I'm doing now, what would be my opinion about this person? There is no room for us to put pride and vanity in this. It is not a game. It's a serious way that we have to face in our journey. So we have to take the advantage and really to analyze what is, you know, under our mental hoods here, and try to do that. There are two ways that we can do that, analyzing ourselves. One would be the self-enhancement way. The self-enhancement way means that when we are just focusing on the positive traits that we have versus the negative ones. So I will be self-enhancing. I will say, oh no, because, you know, see this that I do. And actually, you're right. It's the good things that you do, but you are, you know, not seeing the bad things that are still there. And the other way that should be the one that we should be using in this purpose, you know, this goal and achieving this goal, which is self-verification. When I will be looking for accurate information about who I am, whether it's positive or negative. But it's very important for us to go through this way. And all of that we are doing today, we reflect what is going to happen in the future. Many of us sometimes would like to have, a crystal ball or someone that would say what is going to happen in our future. And Abraham Lincoln actually has a phrase that I like very much that he says, the best way to predict your future is to create it. So this is what we are doing now. This is the invitation. This is what Spiritism is all about. It is not about just giving us knowledge. It is about helping us in this process of spiritual growth. It is because of that, that, you know, to make it very clear that Allan Kardec in the Gospel According to Spiritism, chapter 17, Be Perfect, item 4, he says, true Spiritists are recognized by their moral transformation and the efforts they make to overcome their evil inclinations. So he was making a statement to say everything that we are bringing, it is for you to start the process. We are not going to become perfect in just 1, 2, 10, 1,000 reincarnations. It's a long process. It's a long journey. But the point here is the self-awareness, to know why we are doing this, to know that this is going to lead me to what I, to my, towards my goals. There are, you know, to have this peace, to have this happiness in a way that we still do not know. That's what Jesus said. Happiness is not of this world, not the happiness in the true meaning of the word, as the evolved spirits know. So in this whole process, Emmanuel, in a message of the book Pathway, Truth, and Life, he talks about knowing and doing. And this is where we are now. Many of us here, we already have enough knowledge from different ways of spiritual values or spiritual organizations, religions, philosophies, even from our material lives, laws that we have that it leads us to become good citizens. But especially for those that are really embarking in this journey of paying attention to them as immortal spirits, as children of God. What are we doing with all this knowledge? Nowadays, it's so easy to acquire knowledge. We have so many important talks that we can access very easily. We can stay 24/7 listening to live talks and Spiritism and other religious presentations. So Emmanuel starts quoting John chapter 13, verse 17, saying, if you know these things, blessed. Blessed are you if you do them. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. That's why sometimes, you know, you say, oh, but there is so much repetition. I already heard that so much. I already know this by heart. Okay. But are you doing it? Blessed are you if you do them. So Emmanuel says that there is a big difference between knowing and doing. And in this path, in this journey, it is important to know. It is when we are working with our reason, gathering the information, why should I be doing that? And now it's when I'm going to go to the next stage. So according to Emmanuel, nearly everybody knows, but few do. Generally speaking, he says that religious sects only teach what constitutes the good. All of them have officials, believers, and disseminators. but true disciples are becoming scarcer and scarcer. What it is to be a true disciple? A true disciple, what characterizes a true disciple is when the message of Jesus reaches your heart. And more than just being touched and impressed by it, you are going to use these teachings to transform you. It doesn't make you instantly perfect, but it's a process. We are going to be building up in this process. So Emmanuel says that there are those that have poor voices that, you know, they can point the way. They point the way. This, according to him, or these people, are those that know, the ones that know. Few individuals courageously enter upon the path, and they often do that in silence. They are forsaken, misunderstood, and this is the supreme effort of those who do. By reading that, by meditating upon these words of Emmanuel, we can not avoid thinking about the teaching of Francis of Assisi when he says, go and preach the gospel and use words if necessary. It's not about words, it's about doing. And even when we are here, you know, giving a presentation like we are giving now, words are going to come out different, with a different energy when we see that the people that are doing it, they are following Kardec's advice. They are making efforts to becoming better. So it is very important for us to know the difference between learning and practice, knowing and doing. Yesterday in the talk that we had with George Elaha, he mentioned that. He talked about, you know, it is no longer time just to feed our intellect. We had to feed our hearts. And we have to produce fruits. If we are truly acquiring and understanding the words of Jesus. Joanna de Angelis, in the book Empty Lives, and she knows when she talks about empty lives, and she calls our attention to say, listen, it's no longer time for you to be living these empty lives. It's time to feed yourselves with the source of eternal life. And so she says, keep in mind that in every self-illuminating achievement is realized with tenacity and love, trust and dedication. So this is why Jesus, understanding that more than his words and considering how difficult it would be for us at that time when he was with us, that we were very still in beginning our process of spiritual growth, he gave us the ultimate example of accepting being sacrificed so that this example would impact forever our souls. So here, when we are talking about spreading this knowledge, when we are talking about this process of inner transformation, it is only by example that we are going to be able to help those around us to transform the world. And to end our presentation today, we have received a psychographic message in relation to the Sermon of the Mount and how this can impact people. And I would like to read them to you and to ask you to meditate upon these words and everything that we are talking here today. And we will continue. We still have more to come today and tomorrow. So the message goes as following. On the proximity of the Sea of Galilee, a group of men marched unattended. They were thieves trying to gain advantage of the pilgrimages of the way. They heard a prophet preaching in that area, and that seemed to be a wonderful opportunity to make some profit. They followed the multitude and waited for the best occasion for unburdening those believers of their possessions. Their hearts were hardened. Life had been difficult for them. Many were abandoned at an early age and had to learn to fend for themselves, while others faced overwhelming challenges. They were so completely despised by their fellow beings that there was no place in their hearts for pity. They believed they had no choice but to ruthlessly take the most they could from life. They waited until the people had calmed down, sitting peacefully as they waited for the prophet to speak. Then a voice, strong yet tender, was saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth." And as the men continued, they felt paralyzed. Some of them wanted to move and to escape from the torpor that invaded them, piercing their souls. Those captivating words spoken with so much love and compassion froze them in their place. While the people around them bathed in tears and completely in awe, tried to absorb the meaning of the words the prophet was saying. They felt an uncontrollable desire to cry, and tears were rolling down their faces. Who was that man? It seemed that he was looking straight at each one of them. They could see his eyes meeting theirs. They could hear his voice dominating their being. And they felt caressed, protected, and loved like never before. My friends, we are far from understanding the power and love of Jesus. We are far from feeling the same expression of love that came from Jesus' heart. But we can still help our brothers and sisters as Jesus did. Remember that the criminals and wrongdoers of this earth lack love and affection. Do not refrain from praying for them and for all who are forgotten or hated by the world, because the Master Jesus is always with us, providing his strength and his love whenever we assist our destitute siblings. Do not tire of loving and giving your attention, and you will be surprised at the transformation your giving will bring about within all those who were able to receive your kind words and prayers. May the love of the God be with you, and may the compassion of Jesus be your perennial source of inspiration. Let us go strong and believing in ourselves, believing that we are not alone, that the good spirits are here to help us, that Jesus himself is by our side and is inviting us constantly to follow him in this journey. Because remember, Jesus is the path to truth and life. Bless you all.
Wow, this is amazing, isn't it, Richard?
Yes, it was, absolutely. Great, yes. Great presentation. Thank you very much, Jusara, for this excellent presentation.
Yes, I would say the same, Richard, sorry, that the words through Jusara of wisdom and comfort, and of course, for those of us who live in the U.S., the parallel of inner transformation, the Sermon on the Mount, and Benjamin Franklin's 13 virtues are perfect.
This was very intense, very deep, and I hope every one of you enjoyed it. And we are now ready to proceed to the next event we're going to present.
Yes, so if you're joining us now, welcome back. Welcome. If you're coming back, welcome back. And we are here for the 10th Spiritus Congress. And as we continue with our amazing program, we're now ready for a treat. João Paulo Ferreira will join us now with a musical number. But before he begins, I would like to introduce him. João Paulo Ferreira was born in Pernambuco, Brazil, and he has lived in Portugal for the past 8 years. He does have a classical music training and began to study music when he was quite young. I think he was only 11 years old. Music is his passion, and he has have music part as part of his life, his whole time, right? His whole life he had the music that is ignites him, and I want him to use this passion to ignite us in the next few minutes. Thank you so much, João, for being here today. Wow. What an amazing, amazing gift to us. Thank you. Thank you, Sei. Thank you for bringing João Paulo Ferreira to us today. But hope you all enjoyed today's program as much as I am. And note that the presentation by Jussara Korngold will be available in Sei's YouTube channel in Portuguese next Monday. So, Richard, do you want to say something before I announce our next activity?
Yes, I would like first to say thank you to João Paulo. That was incredible performance. I know he did put all his art into this preparation. Really, thank you very much, João Paulo. You did a great job. We are very grateful for that. And we are also expecting to listen more tomorrow, because João Paulo is going to also to offer us 10 more minutes by tomorrow for the Block 5, if I remember well. So thank you.
This is great. Great to hear him. Great to hear him tomorrow, right? And our souls are lifted with such beautiful voice. But anyways, it is time for our next activity, our roundtable in English. So I would like to invite all of you to the panel of spiritists from different countries to discuss inner transformation and mediumship. The next roundtable is in English, and our guests represent spiritist organizations in Central and North America, UK, and Australia. I believe the following spiritist organizations are represented: the United States Spiritist Federation, the Cadena Heliosófica Guatemalteca, forgive me for my Spanish, and the Australian Spiritist Federation. I would like to invite everyone for this interesting talk. Thanks, everyone. Welcome. Welcome, everyone, to the 10th World Spiritist Congress. My name is Marcia Trajano, and I'll be moderating a roundtable today about inner transformation and mediumship. I would like to bring our panel speakers that we're here together celebrating the 30th year of the International Spiritist Council, and the 10th Congress, as we know, as it happens every 3 years. I would like to, first and foremost, let you know that we have representatives from all over the Americas and the world that speak English. So Edwin Bravo from Guatemala will be represented Cadena Heliosófica Guatemalteca. And Edwin, why don't you say hello to everyone?
Hello, everyone. My name is Edwin Bravo. I was born in Guatemala City, and I am speaking from this beautiful city. So I'm very happy to be with you this evening.
Very good. Thank you so much, Edwin. João Korngold from the U.S. Spiritist Federation. João?
Hello, everybody. I'm very happy to be here on this 10th Spiritist Congress, World Spiritist Congress, and I speak from the city of New York, here in the center of the world, as they say it here.
Awesome. Silvio from the Australian Spiritist Federation.
Hello, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be here with all of you participating with this event. I hope everyone can benefit from it. I'm talking from Sydney, Australia. And I so good to be here. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you, Silvio. Tanya.
Hi, everyone. I'm Tanya Schwartz from the U.S. Spiritist Federation, and I'm in Austin, capital of Texas in the U.S. And it's always a pleasure to be participating with all of you and hoping that we all learn and enjoy together this moment. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you. Thank you, Tanya. It's so good for you to be representing the United States Spiritist Federation. And finally, but not least, Vito from the Canadian Spiritist Council. Vito.
Thank you, Marcia. I'm speaking to you from Edmonton, Canada, and it's a pleasure to be here today representing the loving hearts of the Canadian Spiritist Council.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, let's go ahead and get started because as we're here to talk about inner transformation and mediumship, the first moment, the first thought that comes to my mind is that when Allan Kardec introduced Spiritism and its entire body of work that was published with the Spiritist book, and we talk about introduction, item one, right? He presented to us those spiritual teachings that were channeled mediumistically. So that in itself heightens the role and the responsibilities of a medium. So if we pause a moment, we'll come to the terms of the enormous impact of Spiritism, not so much because it was done mediumistically, but because it proposes spiritual transformation through the moral betterment of each and every one of us. So we're going to spend the next few minutes discussing inner transformation, as I said before, in mediumship. And I would like to perhaps frame our discussion from the perspective of the medium. From a vibrational perspective, and generally speaking, a medium has the capability of connecting to a wide range, a wide spectrum of spirits and their own vibrational areas. From a preparation and readiness perspective, we know that on one hand, inner transformation will impact one's mediumship in general because of how it allows a heightened affinity with spirits of light, pure spirits. Counterposing to that, which is very important in our discussion today, is the fact that mediumship in itself is a tool of moral evolvement for the medium. So, my proposal here is that we talk a little bit about this toolkit for moral betterment, right? AKA inner transformation and its interdependency with mediumship. So, the question that I would like to move on with the topic proper is asked maybe, Joan, can you talk a little bit about mediumship, define what in the world are we talking about, just baseline, what is mediumship, and beyond the role in the codification of Spiritism, why is it important for us to be talking here today?
All right. So when I talk about mediumship, the first important thing that we need to remember is that mediumship is not something that was invented or discovered by Spiritism. Mediumship exists since the first incarnate individual existed on Earth together with the first discarnate individual. What Spiritism did was to expand on the understanding of mediumship and this relationship between the spiritual world and the physical world. So a medium is just an intermediary. It's just someone that has the ability to bring a message from the spiritual world to the physical world through different methods of mediumship, being psychography, psychophony, through a seeing medium, a hearing medium. How does it it differs from the rest of how mediumship is perceived outside of Spiritism? I think Marcia presented that mediumship, according to Spiritism, serves for us to evolve morally and intellectually. Both the mediums and the spirits who are communicating have the opportunity of learning through mediumship and have the opportunity to put those in practice in our daily lives. So different from other mediumship manifestations that, for instance, in ancient Greece, when you have the Delphos, the Delphos Pythonis, right, that would bring messages about what was going to happen in the physical world, mediumship in spiritism, it's more intended to bring us a moral and intellectual elevation, an opportunity to learn and to evolve, not really concerned about things of the physical life, but things of us as eternal spirits.
That's awesome. Thank you. So before, because I really want to zoom in on what you just said, João, but I want to ask, does anyone want to add to João's answer before we move on?
Yes, please. I would like to bring also the fact that when we hear that we are all mediums, right? People always bring this this question, what does that mean? So I think it's important that we understand, like you guys already said, that being a medium, right, being this intermediary, we are always living in this, in communication of the spiritual world. So this constant contact with the spirits in our everyday lives, not only as mediums per se, that will have those capabilities, but the fact that we are influenced through our thoughts, through intuition, we're also being involved by the spirits, and therefore we are going to bring also the inner transformation as how important it is for us to be connected with the high spirits and not with the spirits that will have the affinity. The lower level we are, the lower level we connect in terms of this kind of broader, if we want to say, mediumship. So I thought it's another aspect in yes. mediumship that is broader, but it is part of our lives. So that's...
Thank you. Yeah.
Two cents there.
I love it. Thank you. Thank you for the insight. So let's just shift a little bit, but still working with the thought about that deep connectedness between inner transformation and moral evolvement and mediumship. So Vito, if I may pick on you, I would like perhaps for us to talk a bit about that linkage. So in other words, and João already brought that thought to us, if we understand that the purpose of mediumship is not the process or the phenomenon, right? But the goal is to, I'm not sure if I'm going to be as poetic as you, João, but the goal is to express love, to express service, to express assistance to those that need. How exactly, Vito, is mediumship a tool for our moral evolvement? And I would like to just say to the audience that maybe this is probably an overarching discussion, so I will ask others to help Vito as well. Go ahead, Vito.
Yeah, thank you, Marcia. And indeed, the reflection that João brought to us very beautifully, it is inviting for us to reflect it a little bit more. And I'm sure my friends here in the, around the table will be able to supplement what I have to say. True spiritists are recognized by their moral transformation and the efforts they make to overcome their evil inclinations. That's said by Allan Kardec in item mm-hmm. 4, in chapter 4, 17 of the Gospel According to Spiritism. So if the inner transformation is at the center for a spiritist, aren't we invited to use the mechanisms of mediumship that is neutral in itself to enlighten ourselves? Well, the answer is yes, but how do we do it? What is the north for us as spiritists around the world? So in question 625 of the Spirit's book, Allan Kardec asks, what is the perfect standard that God has offered to humankind as a guide and model? The answer, my friends, is Jesus. And mm-hmm. Allan Kardec goes beyond and say, Jesus is the highest standard of moral perfection to which humankind may mm-hmm. aspire on earth. Mm-hmm. God offers him as the most perfect model, and the doctrine he taught is the purest expression of God's law. because he was animated by the divine spirit and was the purest being that has ever walked on earth. So then, is it enough to say, okay, so I'm a Christian, therefore I got it? Well, he is the one that I asked this question on chapter 18 of the gospel. And it, what we'll see is that in item 16 of this chapter that I mentioned, at chapter 18, he goes on to remind us that true Christians will be recognized by their deeds. So, my friends, it is by using the mechanisms of mediumship to develop the virtues exemplified by Jesus mm-hmm. that we mm-hmm. will give the desired direction that will allow our inner transformation. It is by developing virtues that we act on God's perfect and immutable laws as mm-hmm. Jesus has exemplified to us.
Very good, Vito. And I have a little bit more time, so I'm going to just go ahead and broaden that point, right? Because I believe Tanya mentioned already, we are in perfect spirits, right? We are seeking, that's the reason why we're here on earth, we're seeking that spiritual growth that will lead us to that perfect happiness of the pure world. Can somebody talk about how does it impact that idea that we imperfect spirits using you said beautifully, by the way, Vito, that very a neutral, right? It's a neutral mechanism, mediumship, but how do we invite inner transformation with a neutral mechanism? How does that mechanism can also help us evolve? How can it help us push us through our spiritual growth? Anyone?
If you allow me, I would like
yes,
to.
Edwin.
Yeah, of course. Why we should change? Why we are seeking for this inner and moral evolvement? It's not for we don't have to look for our own happiness because mm-hmm. In that moment it's kind of selfish if we are only looking for our happiness or our own wellness. We need to help others. We need to be humbles and mm-hmm. change our inner moral and ethics. Mm-hmm. We here in Latin America, we have a big opportunity because we are a mixture of many communities, many religions, many ways to believe, and we are very spiritual. Unfortunately, here in Latin America, we have a mediumship that was done incorrectly in the past. So right now we have the opportunity, no, the responsibility to change that. And we can do it through the moral evolution from our beings, not looking for our happiness, but looking for the happiness for the rest of the communities.
Very good. So that you're now talking about done incorrectly, and we don't have time to go through that, but thank you. I think it's a great opportunity for us to study how Latin America has done that. But you bring about the responsibility that we have to do that. So can somebody else talk about it? And I'm specifically looking for mediumship as a tool for moral evolvement.
May I say something?
Of course.
When we talk here about inner transformation, and we talked about the fact we have our model and of virtues, and how, you know, if you look at the part three of the Spirit's book with all God's laws, mm-hmm. you know, so besides having in our conscience, like we all have it there, but there are books there showing us the way, what is it that we are trying to achieve? We cannot get to any goal, any target, if we don't know. We do have the recipes there, what we need to achieve. Mm-hmm. Knowing ourselves, first of all, right? Mm-hmm. I can only get better if I know where I am in this process. I thought it was important that we bring that. It sounds very basic, but sometimes we don't know what we're looking for. And why is mediumship part of this formula to help us, right? So the moment that I know in what areas I need to improve, and we are able to get to this, to use this tool of mediumship, not only in the mediumistic meeting, when we talk to the spirits, we are always spirits, right? Mm-hmm. So that every moment in our lives, every conversation and fraternal conversation that we have, everything that we do, including using the mediumship to help others, in the case of the discarnated spirits, right? We are practicing the law of love that was taught by Jesus, and it's everywhere there in the codification. So we are able to use by the dialogue, by the moment that we help ourselves to transform ourselves, to prepare ourselves to be in that meeting, and we are having that moral authority, in not in authority in a bad way, but what we are saying is what we do, it makes much more sense. But we don't need to be perfect to do that, otherwise we wouldn't be here. But we, as imperfect spirits with the potential to become perfect, we are able to work on this transformation ourselves, help others, and learn from others, being humble to learn from their experience in the mediumistic meeting. What are the things that we're talking about? Revenge, hate, all those bad traits that we don't need to repeat. So that also help us incarnate to be better, to try to be better. So I just thought of giving us some baseline in the where we want to go, what we want to do, right, in our lives.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you, Tanya and Vito. So, and Edwin. So as we keep continue with our conversation, I'm going to shift slightly, because I'm picking up on the message from Tanya, right? The reality is we are all mediums, you and me, and the rest of the 7 billion plus people incarnated on Earth. We're all mediums. And as Tanya also mentioned, as spiritists that are recognized as mediums, we are mediums at the Spiritist Center. We are mediums during a mediumistic meeting. We're also mediums in our day-to-day lives, right? So the result, as Tanya mentioned, is that our thoughts, our actions are key to how we live and carry on. Hence, I would say mediumship, as I think João mentioned, is not a privilege of spiritism or spiritist, right? And I'm thinking, Silvio, all the way from Australia, let's talk a little bit about this topic, right? How I'd love to hear from you. And just to whet our appetite, I'm going to say what's coming to my mind, right? Some ideas that come to my mind is perhaps do we have that moral compass that I know Edwin mentioned Jesus was given to us in the gospel according to Spiritism, right? And in Spiritist book, Jesus as the model of perfection in on earth. But closer to us, perhaps, is there any guidelines? Is there a good medium that you say, yes, that's a good medium? And if there is an example of a good medium, perhaps, Silvio, can you tell us, let's say, pretend, right? I'm here coming to you, and I say, Silvio, you know what? I know I'm a medium, but I don't know that I'm that good of a medium. How can I become one? What do I need to do? So take it away, and I'll ask after Silvio speaks, everybody weigh in as well.
Yeah, thank you, Marsha. As Juan was saying, I mean, there's so many ways that mediumship can be exercise. It all depends on the person's specific ability. But when you're saying, oh, if I pick someone, a medium that would be an inspiring example, we straight away think of Chico Xavier in Brazil, mm-hmm. the famous medium. And as we were talking here, I was just came to my mind the work that Chico did, which was great for people that had the opportunity to be close to him. It was the communication that he brought from children, from parents that were here on earth weeping and suffering from that departure, and those parents not being spiritist at all, not knowing how to react to that, they were able to be there, and randomly, naturally, those messages will come from their children, say, "Hey, hello, I'm here, I'm happy, that's the way it's supposed to be, and life continues." And this was such a consolation and did such a great relief in the hearts of those parents to know that their children will survive and one day they'll be all reconnected. So that's just one example. But we're also talking about here in a transformation, and that's the thing that within the spiritist realm is something that we need to do, and it's so evident for us that we need to improve ourselves. But with the mediumship, and when you're there working with the spirits, and generally as we do in spiritism, you actually invited, you are inspired to improve ourselves with just the contact with the spirits, because there's a whole variety of spirits. We love them all, of all ranges, no matter where they come from or where they found themselves. We love them all, but everybody wants to be in contact with the higher spirits. They are incredibly lovely. They're inspiring. They bring beautiful messages. And, of course, we want to do it right. We want to be in contact with them. And, therefore, we need to be able to associate with them. And the only way to do is to resemble how they are. And then we need to improve our character, our actions, to be able to be in that position, to be in contact with them, and to have a serious work that will work to help people. And to help people is the way to go. And we see that the importance of exercising love and compassion for those spirits that are there. And it's interesting to see that some of them don't even know that they are dead. And this is incredible, because life is so real after life that even confused people that are there. And then the stories that they bring, it brings us to tears. And we, when we finish this exercise, we go, I got to do better. I got to improve myself. It's so clear for us. They bring us this so clear to us that what we do today, it's what we're going to be in the future. The repercussions are incredible. And the past bringing today. So they say, I got to do better. So this invitation to improve, it's there, it's clear, and that's what inspires us. And that's why we give so much importance to do that everywhere, as Tanya was saying, everywhere we go, whenever we find ourselves with inside the spiritual center on our daily life, to be better, to exercise love and generosity to people is the way to go.
Love it, love it. Thank you so much, Steven. And I think this is speaks to me deeper than I imagined, right? Which is the what I call the point counterpoint, and I'm putting my two hands in front of me, right? They while inner transformation will push you to become better as we go through your own journey of inner transformation, knowing yourself and as such, look in your shadow, right? Look at all the vicissitudes that you are going through now as a reflection of your past, but also pushes you to see not from a judgment, but also from a place of love, that as we become, we enhance our qualities, right? We also become better on that vibrational, that energy level that we're going through. But the counterpoint to that, which is the pain. And I love what you said, Silvia, because not only there's an inspiration beyond the tears, right, but also the fact that as a medium, right, through feeling the pain during that mediumistic contact, you already experiences some things that maybe, I'm just ad-libbing here, maybe we would have to experience in our own lifetimes with a different type of lifetime experience. So I think this is really great. I appreciate mm-hmm. that. Can someone else speak to that, to the effect that we have that point counterpoint mediumship as a tool to also help us evolve?
Yeah, I was thinking when Sylvia was mentioning Chico Xavier and, mm-hmm. and the consoling messages that he received mm-hmm. from the families of lost loved ones, that it shows also throughout the history of his mediumship, how his mediumship changed in the sense mm-hmm. of helping others, right? Because he mm-hmm. used to do a lot of materializations in the beginning of his mediumship
Correct.
Journey. Mm-hmm. And then at a certain point, Emmanuel told him, let's stop with the materializations. Because what happens is the mediumship of physical effects or physical phenomena, it's very interesting for those that are watching it, but it doesn't bring us anything outside the group. Right, you see a spirit materialize in front of me. I can be very surprised and very excited, and then I tell my neighbor, and my neighbor look at me and said, "I don't believe you," and that's the end of the story. Right? When you receive a letter of a departed loving one, the parents can show to the neighbor, and even if the neighbor doesn't believe, it will touch him or her.
So I love it.
That's yeah. mediumship as a tool of moral transformation for us that the physical phenomena does not bring. So when Silvia was mentioning that, I was thinking about this a part of life of Chico Xavier.
And mm-hmm. and João, just to and maybe anyone else, just to give a sense, and I'm assuming that most of us know who Chico was and Emmanuel, who? What are you talking about? So can somebody give a 30-second review of who Chico was and the timeline of his mediumship?
So Chico Xavier is probably the most famous medium in Brazil, considered by many the most important Brazilian that ever lived. He started his mediumship when he was around 20 years old. You can find movies in the internet about his life. And Emmanuel is his spiritual guide, what we call in Spiritism, protecting spirit, guardian angel. That's Emmanuel for Chico Xavier. And he always directed and instructed Chico Xavier how to behave in his life. His three rules were discipline, discipline, and discipline that Chico had to follow, meaning the seriousness of how we have to address mediumship, which is also important as a tool of moral evolvement. We have to take it very seriously. So I think that's my 30 seconds.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you.
Marcia, yes. If I may, still in this, one thing that when Sylvie was talking about the consolation through mediumship, and that again makes me think of how important it is for us to use that experience, not only to the discarnate, because why is it so much easier for us to have compassion when mm-hmm. a spirit in a mediumistic meeting is explaining their limitations, their problems, their imperfections, and the things that they went through and caused them to be where they are right now. And sometimes we don't have that same compassion if we hear that of another incarnate human being, right? Yeah. So I just want to bring it. I know the topic is mediumship, but since we're talking about we are all mediums all the time, correct. I thought that was important to bring up, right? Let's use that to help us really grow, the inner transformation is all the time. So it is part of listening to people's issues and being able to help also.
No, I love it. Yeah, I love it. And I may have an answer to that. And the answer to why, because it's an age old question, right, Tanya? Why do we, you know, mediums working in a mediumship, mediumistic session, and we do such good to those that come in that environment, and we are, it's just, we're amazing. How can we conduit to healing? Right, to empathizing with the pain and help that that spirit come out of what they're going through and move on. And the answer is twofold, right? Number one, we are at that time protected by a group of spirits that are protecting us, helping us, including expanding our level of ability to help, right? So that's one. But the other one is simply put, we're paying attention, right? We are paying attention. We're there with the soul focused to paying attention to the pain. And I think I would just say call to action to everyone. Let's pay attention. And that sense of compassion that is exercised, and it is, to me, the catapult for us to evolve morally through mediumship. It is, let us pay attention to my pain and your pain, right? Let us all be the vessel by which we can listen and we can accept, we can embrace anyone who's going through pain, incarnate and disincarnate. So thank you, Tanya, for allowing that. Anyone else before we move on?
Yeah, I just want to say as well that, and if my memory is serving me today, item 197 of the Medium's book, goes to say and bring a little bit more detail of what a good medium is. So if for those ones that are interested and the examples that we've listened to here today, we're gonna see that it perfectly matches, applies to those characteristics that Allan Kardec is talking in the book. And and my message for all of you and for all of our friends that wants to know more about mediumship, please, there was a few books that we referenced here tonight, the Spirits book, Gospel According to Spiritism, the Medium's book, and there are much more, but all of those, including there are available for free in the International Spiritist Council website. So please, instead, there's a lot of there. We know that as we saw here today, it's through the virtues, through applying those virtues that we really gonna develop. But there are elements of knowledge available out there.
Awesome, thank you. So just to give to any, the person who's a novice in Spiritism, who's here perhaps by chance, perhaps not, Allan Kardec's five initial books, right, that became the basis, the foundation for what we call Spiritism today, right? They are Who Can Help Me, Spirit's Book, Medium's Book, Gospel According to Spiritism, The Genesis, and Heaven and Hell. So all of those are available, as Vito mentioned, in SEI's website, and you can download. You can also study them. Kardecpedia.com is another great site for you to study. So the information is there, and we urge each and every one of you and us to learn more. All right, we are such a great conversation. Thank you. Thank you for all your help. Let's go ahead and see. And I do have a few minutes of time. So let's shift a little bit of our conversation, right? And we mentioned, number one, that the medium has a number of responsibilities, right? And João mentioned in his 30-second pitch about who Chico Xavier was. Thank you, João. He mentioned Emmanuel. Emmanuel is that the mentor, the protecting spirit, the guardian angel. There are many, many ways to call Emmanuel. But Emmanuel worked alongside, in addition to being that benefactor, that mentor to Chico, like we all have one, by the way. But they worked together and they wrote many books in close partnership. Emmanuel as the spiritual author and Chico Xavier as a medium. So in one of those partnerships, Emmanuel dictated to Chico the book, The Consoler. Specifically there, Emmanuel talks about those responsibilities. So specifically, he says, you know, I heard you, João. Discipline, 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 he said throughout Chico's life, right? But he says in the book, your medium, your responsibility is to study, it is to work, it is to dedicate yourself. It is to exemplify fraternity and your inner transformation. So I'm going to break this into two questions. Okay, are you ready? So I want Edwin to tell me I don't know if you read or not, Edwin, but if you were to have read and you were to think about Emmanuel telling you study, work, dedication, fraternity, and inner transformation, what do you think, Edwin, are the expectations of a medium from that perspective? And I'm going to shift to Tanya as the other side of this question, which is in concert with or beyond inner transformation, what are the key, so Edwin, expectations, and Tanya, key responsibilities of a medium. So Edwin, take it away and let's all add to this discussion until the
sure thing.
End.
Yeah, of course. mediumship is a gift, and it's not only a gift for the medium, but as well for the community where the medium is. So the medium at the beginning will start slowly, baby steps, working with their community. But as João mentioned before, it's a path with a lot of dedication. Mm-hmm. And if you want money in your material life, you have to work. And if you ask money for God to God, God will send you work. And it's the same thing for the mediumship. Mediumship is a path where you have to work a lot. You have to make a lot of charity, and it's a big opportunity to provide a good message for your community. And only, and you have to make very humble, not to to be aware that the content of this message is not only for your community; it's as well for yourself. Mm-hmm. So the expectations for the medium is to work a lot, mm-hmm. but you don't have to say you don't have to see it as a heavy lift for yourself. You have to see it like a beautiful effort for the wellness of your moral and ethic in the future.
Awesome. And yes. This is awesome. Thank you, Edwin. And right. I think you're spot on, right? The expectation is, it doesn't come for free. You're not going to become a millionaire. Most likely you will not. You have to triple work beyond your physical responsibilities on earth. But it's a beautiful, beautiful effort. Did I hear anyone wanting to add to this?
I just said mediumship is a blessing.
Yes, yes, it's a blessing. Thank you, João. So Tanya, bring back to you before we can start to wrap up today's conversation. So we talked about expectations, right? So what are the responsibilities there? And think in terms of, I can see my mind's eye, Emmanuel talking to Chico. You and all other mediums, this is what you need to do. What are the responsibilities, Tanya?
Well, I guess we mentioned a bunch of them already, mm-hmm. but let's reinforce that. Always, like we said, enlightenment, the studying, the knowledge, knowing what we're doing, educating ourselves in what we're doing. According to Spiritism, you know, there is a whole process. It's not like, you know, even if you already have that ability, you know, you come to the Spiritist Center, we need to know how to use it in the benefit of others, right? So to educate ourselves, study, to apply ourselves, right? So it's a commitment. It's a commitment to the institution we are working, to the people we're working with, to the spirits that are there. You know, we talk about the spiritual guides and the mentors. Well, they are organizing all these meetings that we are going to be participating. We cannot just say, you know, I don't feel like it today. I'm just going to stay home, right? There is a lot. When talk about discipline in what we do, the way we do things, and the everyday effort to really become a better person, to apply what we were talking before, so that we are more ready for that kind of work that we are going to be doing. So there is, it's not like I have it, I'll just go whenever I want. And also participating in the community, in the work that is done in our Spiritist Center and the social work that we do in the Spiritist Center. It's kind of really, it's a blessing, but we need to feel that in our hearts. It's not, all of us here mentioned, it is definitely to use that to help others. We are the ones that get the most benefit out of it. And when we feel that, it's easy because it's part of our life. It's the same thing as the things that we do with love and care. So anyway, I don't know if that's what you all had in mind, you guys. Complete about all the responsibilities, but that's what came to mind.
Now, this is awesome. So any final words before we start to wrap up our session today?
Just
from quickly, anyone? Go ahead.
The responsibility of a medium to educate oneself is an understanding that the medium is a vessel, but the vessel needs to be as clean as possible. A dirty glass will fill of water and the water will become dirty. If we are not a clean vessel, we are going to distort the message from the spiritual world. And then the education will help us, the education more evolving will help us improve this vessel to be a better instrument of the spirit, for the spiritual world.
That's awesome, thank you. We are approaching our end, and I just wanted to grab a key comments and trends, right? What we talked about, it is a blessing. It is the blessing that comes with a lot of responsibility, but it is the awareness that as we are in this path toward our own progress, right? Progress is a part of the process, and it's the end goal itself. The more progress we do, the more progress we reach, right? So it's a little twist in our brain in terms of our thoughts. And inner transformation and mediumship to me is very similar. It's this intertwined process where you need inner transformation to make better use of your mediumship. And it is our moment for us to go ahead and become better. Before I close, does anyone want to say a final thought? Just goodbye, and then I'll close. Go ahead. I'm going to start first with Vito this time.
Thank you.
Any
Marcia.
Final thought? Yeah.
No, I just want to really thank the group. I feel blessed of being here tonight, reflecting with this very select group about that important topic for all of us. There is one attitude towards life that I find very useful to myself, that I've shared, perhaps some will also gonna like it, is that of an idea of an apprentice of life. What that idea is really, as we continue with our living and the vicissitudes of life bring us new invitations, is take it as an apprentice would, and mm-hmm. and try to learn. Okay, so what is now that life is bringing to us, teaching us for our moral, our inner transformation, and if we are able to live this way, perhaps the mediumship will be indeed that just one more tool that life would bring to us for that purpose.
Awesome. So we have just 3 minutes before we end. So Tanya, go ahead and say your final words. But thank you, Victor. Beautiful, beautifully said. Yeah. So we're down to 30 seconds a person.
No, I just want to thank you, everyone. It was great. And let's be vigilant. Let's pay attention and be helpful always. Thank you.
Awesome. Awesome. Silvio.
Yeah, if I could have 30 seconds, what I'd like to bring quickly is that we talk about the medium all the time. I think it's important in looking at what's a good medium is that not let this importance of being a medium to be too much and grow too much into self evaluation. If we can make an analogy to a sound system, the medium is just the speaker. So it's not the music. So the music comes from somewhere else. And it's very important that the speaker is very true to what the music is playing, because if the speaker has distortions, then we won't like it. So it's important that the medium is just a channel, as Joanne was saying, the clean vessel, so not to add anything, because we see a lot of mediums that add things or distort the message, and that's not the result we would like to see. So Emmanuel reminds us that very much so, the responsibilities of being just a clean, transparent vehicle to bring the message from the other side. Awesome. It's a great pleasure to be here with all of you discussing all that and sharing all this. And thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. João, you're 30 seconds again.
Be curious and be open-minded. That's what I tell everybody here and everybody out there. Thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thank you. Edwin?
Yeah, well, we are not perfect spirits. We are here in the material war to improve ourselves. So pray a lot to make good choices in Jesus, and you will see that everyone will be happier in that way. Thank you for having me.
Awesome. So we have come to an end. I want to say thank you. Thank you. Thank all of you who are here watching this roundtable. Thank you, esteemed panel members and the entire team working behind the scenes to make the 10th World Spiritist Congress a reality. Au revoir.
Thank you
for joining us after our roundtable discussion. Love to have you in that discussion panel. And as we reach the end of our day today, I would like to first and foremost thank you, João, as well as Tanya, Silvio, Edwin, and Vito for great time together. Really appreciated being there with you. But it is time to say goodbye. We have reached the end of block 3 of the 10th Spiritist Congress, and I want to thank everyone who's here watching the event, as well all of you who will watch the videos later. But before we close, please note we'll continue the events tomorrow, Sunday, October 16th at 3 p.m. This is Central European time or Paris time. The program includes lectures, interviews, roundtables, and will be delivered in Spanish. I hope to see you all tomorrow. But Jerome, would you like to say something to our viewers before we close? And Hishad, please, I want to say to also hear from you.
Yeah, I just want to say thank you, Marcia, for conducting the panel. It was a very interesting and rewarding panel to be part of. Thank you, Richard, for a wonderful Congress. It has been really a truly amazing experience that we are still in the middle of it, two-thirds of it. We invite everyone to be back tomorrow for the Spanish part and for the closing lecture by Divaldo Franco. Thank you all for participating, for watching, and it was a pleasure.
Awesome. Richard?
That's... What can I say? I mean, it's a fantastic experience and an honor to organize this event and to meet that many people during the round tables, during the preparation, all the volunteers. I will talk more extensively tomorrow about this, but it has been a great experience. I would like to thank all the participants for this block as well, for the English-speaking people. It was really great to prepare, and I hope everyone enjoyed it. And thank you, Marcia, for being there also. That was extremely nice to have these presentations with you. And thank you for all the attending people in the panels, the roundtables, and Jussara for the great lecture she did also tonight. Tonight, this afternoon, or this morning, according to which side of the planet you are. So tomorrow we will switch to the Spanish tempo for quite a while, until the end of the Congress, of course, almost, because we have our beloved brother Divaldo in Portuguese. So I will just say a demain. Have a very good evening or afternoon, and see you tomorrow.
Bye, everyone.
Adema.